So this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us come to God to worship in spirit and in truth, and let us join our hearts and minds in the opening prayer of invocation and confession. Let us pray. Let us, in silence, remember our shortcomings in being God's people this week. As we pray, let us open our hearts to God's power, moving around us and between us and within us, till God's glory is revealed in our love of both friends and enemy, in communities transformed by justice and compassion, and in healing of all that is broken. We gather for worship in the spirit of truth, seeking your wisdom and guidance. We bow down before you with open minds and open hearts, asking you to fill them with all that is noble and good. As we sing hymns, listen to scripture, and break bread together today, may we be assured of your forgiveness. Feel your profound love for us and all of your creation, and be transformed by your loving spirit. Amen. Let us trust in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ in our midst, who forgives us from all sins, seeks to reconcile us and bring us, reconnect us with God's love. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our reading from the Old Testament is a familiar Psalm 23. Let's read it responsively. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters.
He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me.
And our reading, also from the Old Testament, is from Micah, and that's on page 1060 in the Pew Bible. We're reading from Micah chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings? With calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?
Good turnout. How is everybody this morning? You know who I am? No. Of course you don't. what am I doing here? I was invited to be the visiting minister here, right? Today, to lead the worship service, join with all of you, and do a children's sermon. I actually coming up to Salisbury next week to coach a baseball team. Our school, the Taft School, we're playing Salisbury, and they're always really good, so it's going to be a very difficult game. But so I kind of know the area a little bit from just coming up here, but it's very beautiful. And what I do is mostly I teach kids a little bit older than you, high school students. And I try and remind them, as I try and remind myself and churches where I preach, that when we look out, look what's going on outside right now in this month of May. When you walk to church this morning, what's happening out there? Yes, look at these beautiful flowers. It's getting warmer. Do you like that? Are you excited about this going towards summer? Yeah? Winter's fun too, but summer's beautiful. One of the great things about New England is we got the four seasons, right? It's so beautiful. I just happened to, just outside my door in my yard here down in Watertown, not too far from here, I just clipped some of these. This, you know what this white one is? Is it a daffodil? So, it's from a little hedge, a little bush called an azalea. Beautiful. What about the purple one? The smell is really great. It's got a great, what is it? Violet. It's kind of got a violet color. Yeah. Lavender violet. I like those. We call it lavender violet. Yeah, sure. I mean, those are great answers. It's lilac. It's a lilac. And then there's actually something in here that just kind of a weed. I don't even know what. It came off a bush. But it's kind of pretty. There are all kinds of things happening. And then how about the pink one? Tulips? Pink like a tulip. It's, here, I'll pass it around. It's off of actually an apple tree. And apple trees have beautiful flowers in the spring. Yeah, and they've got great apples. But you know what? They provide nourishment, food, an apple, and beauty. The eye, you can see these flowers. But the whole idea is there's something in the book of, in the Bible, it says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all who dwell therein, that in Psalm 24. And it's just that this is God's creation. And one of the ways we experience God's love for us, is just looking around at nature. And the world is on fire outside. I mean, with the grass turning green and the trees turning, leaves popping out and the flowers, it's just an amazing thing. And sometimes we can walk right by it. And we can do it at my age, we can do it at my parents' age, any age. And we don't notice it. Sometimes you ever get trapped in the house where you're listening to your headphones or you're looking at the computer? Do you sometimes? Well, I find that with you do? And you can play video games. You really like that, huh? Even on a nice sunny day? Yeah. No. Why? You don't do it on a sunny day? You ever get outside and, like, take a little hike? Take your dog out or your cat and go out? You do? Take the cat on a hike? No. It's pretty hard to do, isn't it? You have to, herding cats. Right. But you like, does anybody like to hike here? You got a lot of hiking trails around here. You do, yeah. Why do you like to hike? The beauty of nature, exactly, yeah, exactly. Yes. Exercise, yes. Those are all great answers. Yeah. See the waterfalls? Ah, perfect. Waterfall, yeah. Because it's a hike. Just do it because it's a hike. Is it like a drudgery for you? I mean, you like to do it or you want to get back home? What? You love hiking. Great. And rock climbing. These are all great answers. It's so beautiful. And just think. What's that? Frogs. Did you say frogs?
Walks in the woods.
With walks. Yeah. Jumping on the trampoline, then you get back from your hike and you can jump on the trampoline. Thank you. Yeah. And you can look at all the, so think about it. When you're enjoying the hike, when you're outside in your yard and you're living in this beautiful area of Salisbury, Connecticut, around here, it is just a beautiful expression of God's love in nature. Because they used to talk about, there's the book called the Bible that we read from on Sunday, but long ago in the medieval period, they also talked about the book of the world, reading the book of the world, and that's the beauty of nature. And God is as much present in everything around us as God is present in us when we're worshiping in this church. God is everywhere. It's like one big church on this planet, one big sacred place. And you, so enjoy it. It sounds to me like you're really enjoying it. And don't take anything for granted, because you know this season of spring is absolutely gorgeous, and I know you know that. And every day, just enjoy it. So thanks very much. Okay. Sure. I guess we'll hold hands. Is that okay? Welcome. I think everyone, we can all join. We can all be in a spirit of prayer together. Gracious and loving God, I give you thanks for this chance to be here with my young friends, these children, and this beautiful day in the spring in Salisbury. We ask a blessing upon them as they go off to Sunday school and throughout the coming week in school. Bless their parents. Be with all of us and help us to see the beauty in this great creation around us. In the name of Jesus, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Let us take this moment to share our gifts with the church. The morning offering will now be received. Gracious and loving God, we offer you these gifts today in gratitude for the gift of our lives, our families, and the many blessings you cast upon us each day. Help us to use them wisely and lovingly to meet the needs of your church and your people everywhere. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I want to share with you the reading from the Gospel this morning. It's from the 5th chapter of Matthew. And I think if you want to, it's very hard to distill down the Hebrew Scriptures and the Christian Scriptures into one passage, but I really think certainly the essence of the prophetic message in Judaism is expressed by Micah in the requirements. What does God require of you? It's very simple, very hard to do. Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with your God. It really encapsulates, the main theme in Judaism and in Christianity. And then we move to Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, bless you, and the Beatitudes. And these really, again, when you think of when you're lost on your spiritual path and you want to get back on track and you want to really contemplate what Jesus taught, you just return to the Beatitudes. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up upon the mountains, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he began to speak to them, and he taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Here endeth this morning's reading from the Gospel of Matthew. May God bless it to our understanding. Amen. Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. You're probably wondering about the strange title, this morning's sermon. And does anyone know what a bodhisattva is? A bodhisattva vow? Raise your hand. You do? Okay. Not too many others. If you grew up in the 60s, late 60s, early 70s, like I did, you know and you love the music from that era. Steely Dan, not too far from here, Bard College, had a song called Bodhisattva. And Cat Stevens, who had The Buddha in the Chocolate Box, was an album that he had in the early 70s. And so maybe that, for some of us in my roughly my age bracket, no. But Bodhisattva is... And I teach, I do this because I teach world religions, and I've been a congregational minister. I'm also ordained in the United Methodist Church. I grew up in the Episcopal Church. None of that really matters, though, because for me, I've become a student of world religions. I'm a Christian. I'm a minister. I serve congregational churches. But for 30 plus years, I've also been a student of Hinduism and Buddhism, and in particular Buddhism. And this term, Bodhisattva, means enlightened being. Bodhi is enlightened. Sattva is being. And but to translate that, you know, because if you look, it comes from the ancient language of India called Sanskrit. And we have our sacred language. We have Hebrew. We have Latin. We have Greek in our sacred texts. And the Quran is in Arabic. You really can't translate the Quran into other languages. It's really the sacred language. It's a language of heaven to Muslims. And likewise, Sanskrit's that language in India for the sacred texts, for both Hindu and Buddhist texts. But Bodhisattva, enlightened being. Well, what is an enlightened being? Enlightened being is one who doesn't seek nirvana, nirvanic bliss, the heavenly realms. I don't want to go into too much detail with that, but they want to keep coming back into the world, being reborn over and over again to save all beings from sorrow and suffering and struggling. You know, and I can think of some common bodhisattvas who aren't in the Buddhist tradition. that you could agree with would be people like Gandhi, people like Martin Luther King Jr., people like Dorothy Day, people like Dag Hammarskjöld, people like Raoul Wallenberg. Living ones would be the Dalai Lama, Nelson Mandela, Bishop Desmond Tutu, people like that, Thich Nhat Hanh, a Vietnamese monk that I love dearly. But then there are bodhisattvas every day that we know, people that aren't in the history books, that aren't well known. You know those people, and some of you here, who are just constantly living to serve and care about others and extend that compassion and that love to others. And the bodhisattva prayer goes, you know, then the reason I'm talking about this is because I was at a conference in Los Angeles 2 weeks ago for prep school chaplains and people teach religion. And it's in prep schools. How do we teach religion? How do we teach more than religion as an intellectual academic course? How do we teach spiritual and ethical values? How do we teach about things like compassion? Things in our schools. We can't do that in public schools. It's great in prep schools. I've been in prep schools for a long time, and it's wonderful we can teach these things. So I was at the conference and with colleagues talking about how we approach teaching religion and so forth, spiritual values, compassion. And the day I was leaving, I happened to notice on the news that the Dalai Lama was going to be at Long Beach. So I look at the map, it's a 45-minute drive south of LA. I've got a red-eye flight coming back to New England. And I said, I got time, but I go down, it's probably sold out. The Dalai Lama sells out wherever he goes, North America, Europe, anywhere around the world. People flock to see him. So I jumped in the car, and so I'm going down there. It was sold out, but there was a wonderful woman whose husband couldn't make it, and she sold me a ticket even at half price. I got it, so I got in. And finally, I've seen a lot of Buddhist monks that I really enjoy, but I've never seen the Dalai Lama, and I talk about him all the time in class. And finally, so Richard Gere, of course, comes out. He's a big Buddhist guy, and he comes out and introduces him. But the thing about the Dalai Lama is 10,000 people in this auditorium, and you could hear a pin drop. He comes out, he's bowing like this. And the reason, and I love the bows, because when you bow like that in Buddhism, you're bowing to the Buddha nature in the other. You're recognizing that Buddha nature. When you bow like that in Hinduism, namaste, if you bow to the divine in the other. Benedictine monks in the Christian tradition do that. You honoring it. The Quakers talk about the spark, the divine within. Jesus said the kingdom of God is within. And you're honoring that and you're recognizing that. And it's beautiful. And it doesn't matter who that person is. They might be your enemy. It might be somebody you find very difficult. They still have Buddha nature. They still have Christ nature within them. To honor that, it's beautiful. So he comes out and he talks and he dismisses everything. People say I'm a God king, I'm the living Buddha, I'm a great healer. He says it's all nonsense. He just starts laughing. He says, if I was a great healer, I'd heal this itch that's been bothering me for 2 years in the back of my neck. And he starts itching his neck. And he laughs. He's got this playfulness and this great joy. It's such a common sense basic message about living with compassion toward a neighbor and with love, with loving kindness toward our neighbor. So I thought about that, and I know when the Dalai Lama became the Dalai Lama, like most Buddhist monks, when you go to a Buddhist monastery or a meditation center, you sometimes chant the Bodhisattva vow, and it goes like this. May I be a guard for all who need protection. A guide for those who are on the path. May I be a raft, a boat, a bridge to take those who wish to go over the flood in this world. May I be a lamp for those who are in darkness. May I be a resting place for those who are weary. May I be healing medicine for those who are sick. May I be a vase of plenty, a tree of miracles. And for all the boundless multitudes of living beings, may I bring sustenance and awakening, enduring like earth and sky until all beings are freed from sorrow, until all are awakened. That's the vow the Dalai Lama takes, and all Buddhists, lay Buddhists as well. And I was thinking about that. And there's such similarities between that and the prayer of St. Francis. And I really think that in a broad sense, I'm doing generalities here, but that vow really encapsulates a lot of the great Eastern religious traditions. And if we were to move to St. Francis' prayer, I really think the Abrahamic faith, if you've been Judaism and Christianity and Islam, we could find similar teachings to what St. Francis is emphasizing with his prayer. You know, he says, so the prayer, which you maybe you know, it wasn't actually St. Francis. He didn't really write it like so many things. But yet, it gets at the essence of what St. Francis was about in the 12th century. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, let me bring light. Where there is sadness, let me bring joy. And grant, O divine master, that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to love, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. And one of my favorite teachers was a Hindu and taught at Berkeley for 40 years in English literature. He's from India, but he writes a lot on Christian theologians and mysticism and Christian writers. And he said that he changed that to, when I die to my smaller self, then I am born to eternal life. And I think he's right on with that, because when we die to our smaller selves, we sometimes get into this constricted world inside of ourselves. Everything's revolving around us and our own needs and who we are. And once you're in that place, you're encased in that self-absorbed place, which is easy to do because the things around us in our society teach us to do that. We suffer a lot more. But when we see how large and expansive we are, and how we're interconnected and part of everything and part of one another, There's a liberating thing that happens to us. So we die to our smaller selves, our smaller needs, and we see that we're connected to a congregation, a community, a nation, a world. And what I really love and always emphasize about what the Dalai Lama said, and it was interesting because I called my wife and said, guess what, where I am? I'm seeing the Dalai Lama, and she's back in Connecticut listening to public radio. And she said, Bishop Desmond Tutu's on. He's talking about, he was talking about the Dalai Lama. So, really interesting. Here's a well-known Christian bishop, Anglican bishop in South Africa, talking about the Dalai Lama. Very similar, we're all on similar planes. And what the greatest thing about this is that 10,000 people are gathered, and what they want, we want a different world. We want a different way of relating to one another. We're kind of tired of all the mean-spirited things going on in politics and in the business and world of commerce and all the wars and the wars that are coming up in the future. We want something different. We're having a hard time as people trying to articulate that. But it's going to be filled with loving kindness, compassion, forgiveness, beyond tolerance, an acceptance and understanding, a pluralistic culture where we can understand and embrace, accept the other who's different than us, and engage them in a dialogue in a respectful way. We want it kind of a different world. And the Dalai Lama says this, and I think it's really true, that if I'm a Tibetan monk, if I say I'm a Tibetan monk, or I'm the Dalai Lama, I speak Tibetan, and all these things are secondary qualities. They're not the primary. The primary qualities is that I'm a human being like you. All human beings across the board want love, they want peace, they want happiness, they want good things for their family. We all want this. Somebody asked him a question. There was somebody up there reading a question, 10,000 people, they passed some notes up. They asked one, he says, what's the difference between Eastern culture and spirituality and Western? He just shook his head and he said, no difference. East, West, North, South, no difference. All same. Everyone's the same. We want the same things. Our culture, our facial features, our skin color, our religion may be different, but those are, again, secondary qualities. What's primary is that we are human beings on this planet. And we want, that's not 11 o'clock, is it? Have I been going that long? Sorry. I don't have a watch. My wife is home in bed sick with the flu. She's usually out there going like this. The first sermon was okay, and then when you went into the second one, then we're really, and then the third one. So please, okay. So the Dalai Lama. Yeah. And so that's what inspired me. I'm thinking, let me go back to these two prayers and the similarities and bringing together East and West. But there is no difference between East and West. We're one global planet. We're one people. I want to just say, so how do we flesh this out? How do we live with, become God's instruments of peace, love, and justice? How do we become a resting place for the weary and a lamp for those in darkness? The darkness of what? The darkness of anger, of hatred, of delusion, of not seeing clearly. Getting, you know, in despair and depression, all the resentment, envy, all those things, that's the darkness. We want to light a lamp to help people out of that darkness. We all get trapped in there. I get trapped in there. But it's being mindful and aware. Now, a few things, ways you can help on the spiritual journey. What I was thinking about some things, what I think, and a lot of other writers far more intelligent than me have said about spiritual maturity. And I have just a few points to make. One is non-idealism. Non-idealism, that, you know, we get so wrapped up in ideologies, political, economic, religious ideologies. And I teach a course on terrorism, terror in the name of God, I call it. And it's looking at the five warning signs when religions become corrupted, when they become evil. And it doesn't, and I start with Christianity, and I, you know, Islam doesn't come in until a little bit later, a few religions down the road. But we look at Christianity, we look at Judaism, we look at Hinduism, we look at Buddha, even Buddhism, my Buddhism, which is the most nonviolent, and Islam. And when do they go off the track? Things like blind obedience and absolute truth claims and just the end times theories, you know, the world's going to end apocalyptic. And if we look at some of those things, but it's when people get wrapped up in ideologies and they want to talk, when they're talking about purifying themselves, then you're in trouble because, you know, separating themselves from the other. And maybe we shouldn't think, the Nazis wanted to purify things. Social Darwinists, the eugenics movement, wants to purify things. Even the Puritans, some of them wanted, you know, the witch trials here in New England 300 years ago wanted to become pure. But maybe we have to, maybe the spiritual life not about seek, not about gaining or attaining, but it's about love. It's about love and loving people and trying to understand where they're at. Maybe the perfections in our, that we are imperfect. Loving people with all their flaws. And I know, starting with me, I have many. And I want to share a little story about that. Now, there's a holy fool called Nasruddin. And everyone in the Eastern religions know, from the Middle East to Asia, they know about Nasruddin. And they're wonderful stories. They're kind of a mechanism to teach about spirituality. This is the holy fool Nasruddin. One day in the marketplace, he encountered an old friend who was about to get married. The friend asked the mullah if he ever considered getting married. Nasruddin replied that years ago he wanted to get married, so he set out to find the perfect woman. First, he traveled to Damascus, where he found a perfectly gracious and beautiful woman, but he discovered that she was lacking a spiritual side. Then his travels took him to Istanbul, where he met a woman who was deeply spiritual, comfortable in the world, and beautiful as well. But they did not communicate well together. There was no chemistry. Finally, he was in Cairo. And there he found the ideal woman. She was beautiful, she was spiritual, she was gracious, and she was at ease in the world. She was perfect in every way. Well, asked the friend, did you marry her? No, Nasruddin answered wryly. Unfortunately, she was looking for the perfect man. You know, maybe you can relate to that, you know, just, we can't get wrapped up in this whole thing of perfection. We can't get wrapped up in ideologies. The second one is about, you know, practicing loving kindness. How do we do that? You know, one of the first things we have to start with and is loving kindness, you know, walking humbly with our God, as Micah said. Kindness is based, and this is a guy named Jack Kornfield, somebody I love to read. He's Jewish, he's Buddhist, he's a psychologist. He writes lots of wonderful books on spiritual things. Kindness is based upon the fundamental sense of self-acceptance. Rather than guilt, blame, and shame for the ignorant acts we have committed, we call them sins. We get wrapped up, you know, and in Buddhism they say we commit terrible things because we're ignorant. We're not aware. We don't see clearly. Or sometimes we commit things because we're fearful, we're insecure, the things that we're fearful about. But Cornfield says it's not perfection of ourselves that's important, but it's the perfection of kindness, of loving kindness in our relationships. He says we need to, kindness asks us to be in touch with mercy, with mercy the parts of ourselves that we have denied, we have cut off, we have isolated. So it begins with ourselves. How do we treat ourselves with respect? Remember Jesus said, love God, love neighbor, and love self. A healthy sense of self. We're not talking about a big balloon ego that I'm the only one in the world. But loving your respect for yourself and caring about yourself, it has an effect. So it begins with transforming yourself, treating yourself kindly. There's a wonderful Buddhist prayer that's like a mantra that people use. May I be filled with loving kindness. May I be well. May I be peaceful and at ease. May I be happy. Something that you do in meditation. And then you extend that to family. Then you extend that to people you hardly know. And then you extend it to enemies, people you find difficult. May they be filled with loving kindness. It transforms your inner consciousness, transforms the lens through which you see the world, transforms your heart. You begin to see things differently. You know, this wonderful Thomas Merton, great Trappist monk, he wrote this in his journal. Then it was if I suddenly saw the secret beauty of their hearts. The depths of their hearts were neither sin nor desire nor self-knowledge, where neither sin nor desire nor self-knowledge can reach. The core of their reality, the person that each one is in the eyes of the divine. If only they could see themselves as they really are. If only you and I could see ourselves as we really are. If only there would be no more war. There would be no more hatred. There would be no more cruelty. There would be no more greed. I suppose the big problem would be that we would fall down and start to worship each other. It's Thomas Merton, wonderful, daunting intellect, compassionate, wonderful Trappist monk in the 60s, friends of Martin Luther King Jr., friends of the Dalai Lama. But if we could see ourselves, we could see into the divine nature within everyone, one another. If we could treat one another with true dignity and respect. When you create that space, and you do that, even around people that say, oh, that person, I know that person, they're really difficult. No, not at all. They have the divine spark within them. God's presence is in there. They have Buddha nature. I'm going to find a channel, a way to draw that out. And you create that space, even the most difficult person. You know, if you're working in, some people, you work in prisons, I've done that before. And you're working with, gangs, or you're working with people really in trouble, difficult times. I still believe they have that nature, and you can find it. And just when talking about patience. Patience is important. I have a story about patience that'll to help us. You know, patience is really important because we're all like, an edge. And if I was to jump in the car when I went to see the Dalai Lama from LA to Long Beach, traffic in LA is crazy. I'm so glad to live in Northwest Connecticut and the beautiful roads. But it would defeat the purpose if I was just so anxious. So I just tried to breathe calmly. Give thanks that I'm going to maybe see the Dalai Lama in this massive traffic jam, six lanes, and had to be patient. Patience is important in the spiritual life. And this story with Zorba the Greek captures patience pretty well, I think. Zorba tells of his own lessons in patience. I remember one morning when I discovered a cocoon in the bark of a tree, just as a butterfly was making a hole in its case, preparing to come out. I waited a while, but it was too long appearing, and I was impatient. I bent over it, I breathed on it to warm it. I warmed it as quickly as I could, and the miracle began to happen before my eyes, faster than life. The case opened, the butterfly started to slowly crawl out, and I shall never forget the horror when I saw how its wings were folded back and crumpled. The wretched butterfly tried with its whole trembling body to unfold them. Bending over it, I tried to help it with my breath in vain. It needed to be hatched out patiently, and the unfolding of wings needed to be a gradual process in the sun. Now it was too late. My breath had forced the butterfly to appear, all crumpled before its time. It struggled desperately, and a few seconds later, it died in the palm of my hand. I think about that, having in situations as a coach, as a teacher,
as a parent, you know, are we forcing somebody too quickly? You know, you think about these great, these private schools in New York where you have people in nurseries, and maybe, I don't want somebody in your families could be doing this, but, you know, they're applying like 1,500 applications for like 20 spots or taking tests when they're 4 or 5 years old. The amount of pressure, I know working in these independent schools, the amount of pressure that kids are under being forced to kind of hatch before their time. But patience. I don't want to go on too long because we have communion and stuff, but seeing interconnectedness is really important. It's a really important thing to see. It's not poetic. It's actually scientifically, absolutely, fundamentally true that everything in this world, in this universe, is interconnected in part. There's really no such thing as an independent self. We are part of everything else. And John Muir says, the great naturalist, when we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it is hitched to everything else in the universe. One little story, too. Okay. In the Amazon, there are over 900 types of wasps. 900 types of wasps. And then there are almost as many, the same amount of certain kind of species of fig trees. The wasps pollinate each of those fig trees. Small animals in the Amazon rainforest feed off the fig trees. And then the larger animals, the jaguars and the monkeys and other animals feed off them. So it's that whole ecosystem and food chain. Everything's interconnected. Every little wasp is important of those different species of wasps and fig trees. And the same is true of us. Sometimes we don't think that our little individual contributions around Salisbury or wherever we are, they make a tremendous difference. We're part of this huge web of life. And what we do makes an awfully large difference. But we are connected to one another. And it's like, you ever see a spider web? You go out in the morning, and in a beautiful morning, you touch it, and it kind of vibrates back for the whole thing. Well, our actions, our thoughts, our words, our actions have a rippling effect, good, bad, or indifferent, in the universe. And last image is talk about flexibility. The beautiful symbol of flexibility is bamboo. Bamboo is, the Chinese have studied it for thousands of years because it teaches them about the mystery of leadership, what leadership is. Because bamboo, you know, you've gone through a bamboo grove before or stand of bamboo. It's so strong. They use it as scaffolding in the Asian countries, but it's flexible. It flows with the wind. So we can't be too rigid on our spiritual journey. We have to be flexible and have that strength, that centeredness for us in Christ, and are rooted in our spiritual life. So those are, you know, there are other things I could talk about, but we have communion, and but to help you think about those things as you try and put in the Bodhisattva vow, live by the prayer of St. Francis, think about what it means to just simply be kind and compassionate each day in each situation, even in those difficult situations. And I thank you for time being able to be here with you today, and I wish you all God's blessings. Amen. Now this is, I think our prayer time is always extremely important. So let us take a moment to center ourselves in Christ and begin in silent prayer. We'll go into silent prayer following the pastoral prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we feel your presence everywhere around us, here in this church, the beauty of nature around us, and the children who come here. You've blessed us in so many ways each day. Help us to be mindful and aware of all of these blessings. We come here to be transformed in heart, mind, body, and soul by your love, by your compassion. To learn how to see the world around us in a new way, see our relationships with others in a different way. We come to break bread together, celebrate Holy Communion. So that we can be reconciled and renewed in our spiritual journey, reconnected to Christ and the Holy Spirit, which lives within us and is among us.
We're mindful of all those names, people who we have lifted up earlier in the day. Michelle and Don and Gloria and Teresa and Dick and Peter and Brian, Saturnino and Heather, Nancy and Dick and Warren and Judy and Barbara and Marty. We lift them up to you. Pray that your healing spirit will abide with them and their family. We pray for the mission troop to Mexico. They travel safely. You will guide them and lead them. They may return safely as they spread your message of love. We take a moment now, O Lord, to pray quietly in our own hearts and minds with our own concerns and our own celebrations. Hear these prayers, O Lord, that we have offered to you in the silence of our hearts. And we pray now the prayer which Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us our debts, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power of glory forever. Amen.
Peace of Christ, which passes all.